My dear friends in Christ, I have the pleasure to welcome everyone again to the Hearts of Jesus and Mary Ministries. Tonight we are going to have two different readings, one from the book of Numbers and the second from Exodus. The first one, we are going to take the reading from Numbers chapter 11, verse 4 to 6. Numbers chapter 11, verse 4 to 6. And the second one shall be Exodus chapter 14, verse 10 to 12. Now I read. Now the mixed multitude who were among them craved more desirable foods. And so the Israelites went again and said, "If only we had meat to eat. We remember the fish we used to eat freely in Egypt. The cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. But now we are dried up and there is nothing at all before us except this manna." And we'll continue with Exodus 14, verse 10 to 12. When Pharaoh got closer, the Israelites looked up, and there were the Egyptians marching after them, and they were terrified. And the Israelites cried out to the Lord, and they said to Moses, "Is it because there is no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in the desert? What in the world have you done to us by bringing us out of Egypt? Isn't this what we told you in Egypt? Leave us alone so that we can serve the Egyptians, because it is better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the desert." And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to you, O God. My dear friends in Christ, tonight, the Lord is talking to us about the pilgrimage of his people, the Israelites. And we are also on a pilgrimage as children of God. And so, in the life of the Israelites, we remember that they were in Egypt for years upon years. The Bible recorded 430 years they were living in Egypt. And God raised a man called Moses to liberate them from Egypt. In Egypt, they were slaves. In Egypt, they were servants. You see the point? They were doing odd jobs. They were just slaves. So, being in Egypt is synonymous with slavery, synonymous with, you know, living a life of bondage. It's synonymous with captivity. And this was the life of the Israelites in Egypt. But God raised Moses and used him to take the Israelites out of Egypt, out of the land of bondage, to the promised land. That is what they called liberation. Many of us need liberation because our foundation has been so faulty. Our foundation is more or less been in Egypt, been in the land of bondage or in the land of captivity. There is something called collective captivity, where a whole family is under bondage, where a whole race, a whole people, a whole nation, a whole continent is under bondage. That's called collective captivity. It's not a talk for the night, though. But some time ago, we had a talk in this ministry called collective captivity. So you may go to the YouTube channel and listen to that message. The Israelites, being a nation, they were living in Egypt under the scope of collective captivity. And you would expect them to be happy that God raised a man to liberate them. And so, that was not the case. Because when God raised Moses, and God used Moses to deliver these people. And while they were at the Red Sea, when they encountered the Red Sea, that Red Sea was an obstacle. There was no way they could cross over. There was no bridge. Okay? Unfortunately, when they looked behind them, they saw the army of Pharaoh coming closer to come and slaughter them. And instead of them crying to the Lord, they now started to challenge Moses. And they said to Moses, is it because there are no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die here in the desert? What in the world have you done to us by bringing us out of Egypt? Isn't this what we told you? Leave us alone so that we remain and serve the Egyptians. Is it not better to serve the Egyptians than to die here in the desert? This was their reward to Moses. Moses saw a lot in the hands of the Israelites. In other words, these people preferred to live in Egypt, to coming out of Egypt. They preferred to live a land of bondage. And that was why they said, why would you bring us out of Egypt? Did we not tell you to leave us alone so that we can serve the Egyptians? Because it's better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the desert. And after this episode, God used Moses to rip open the Red Sea. And we know the story of how the people passed through the Red Sea and how the Pharaoh and his armies were drowned in the Red Sea. God did that amazing miracle. And you will think, oh, this will be the end of the Israelites becoming unfaithful to God. But that was not true. In the book of Numbers, chapter 11, verse 4 to 6, they start to grumble again. They start to grumble again. And at this point, they were grumbling even when God had given them manna. God had already given them manna. But they're not grumbling and saying, look, does it mean that we'll keep eating this manna all the time? Can you imagine that? Jesus. And they said in Numbers chapter 11, verse 6, but now we are dried up. And there's nothing at all because you have only given us manna. We only have manna here. And so they went to attack Moses. Why did you bring us here? To be eating the manna only. To be eating only manna. Day and night, we'll be eating this manna. Why didn't you leave us in Egypt where we eat our desirable foods? Where we eat our desirable meat? And then in Numbers chapter 11, verse 6, they said, we remember the fish we used to eat freely in Egypt. The cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, the garlic we used to eat freely at Egypt. Free food. Free gift. Services without pay. Be careful with it. So even though that physically these people have left Egypt and they were in the desert heading to the promised land, yet they wished they were in Egypt. Psychologically, emotionally, spiritually, their mind were in Egypt. They were in Egypt. You see that? Many of us, even when God had delivered us, even when God had taken us from the land of bondage, love, we still desire the old wine. We desire the old lifestyle. We desire to go back. We desire to eat the apple that the devil used to entice Adam and Eve. This is called backsliding. You are in the church physically, but emotionally you're not there. Psychologically, you are not there. You are in a club dancing, but you're in the church. I have a question. Would a free man who once had been a prisoner of war ever voluntarily return to his former concentration camp to live? That's unthinkable, right? Oh, sure. Galatians chapter 2, verse 17c says unthinkable. Can somebody who has been a prisoner, he has been captured by the enemies. Now, after some time, at the end of the war, this person was set free. Can this person voluntarily say, oh, please don't set me free. Take me back to prison. Take me back to the land of bondage. Take me back to the former concentration camp to live. Can somebody do that? But you know what? We don't do that physically. We celebrate that freedom. We rejoice when we escape death. Yet, God's people do go back voluntarily to their old ways. Yes, God's people, remember the lifestyle when they used to do certain things of the world and they wish to go back. I was ministering some time ago and one lady said, if God does not answer me, I'll drop this Bible and go back. Jesus. I said, please, don't go back. Don't draw the Bible. I could understand her frustration. But going back is not what God wants from you and I. Going back is to backslide. Going back is to reject Jesus. Going back is to go to where you used to be, in the prison. That's what it is. The Israelites escaped the slavery of Egypt. But when times got tough, when the chiefs were down, when the enemies tried to flog them, they preferred to return back to Egypt. They preferred to return to flogging and the constant brick making that they were doing at Egypt or in Egypt, as long as they could eat their fish, their cucumber, their melons, and their garlic. In fact, I missed something, and that is free. F-R-E-E. If I leave this sentence by saying that their meat, their fish and cucumbers and melons and garlic, you might think that they were paying for them. It was free. And so they were missing the free food, the free fish, everything free, even free accommodation. And so they were comfortable in the land of bondage. Even though they were in bondage, but they were comfortable. They were okay. They became very complacent. They didn't want even to come out. They were okay with free food, even though they were in bondage. Does that talk about somebody's life? Because of what they're getting from that relationship, even though it's ungodly, you prefer to remain in it and make the honey or drink the milk because you are making a cow. You want to remain in that relationship even though it is ungodly. But on Sunday, you go to church. The Lord says, it's time to come back. It's time to come back. Good enough. The Lord is talking to us as we have started our 57 days fasting and prayers. And we have just had our first day of this prayer and fasting. And the Lord is ministering to us on this first day to make a resolute decision never to go back, to make a resolute decision to stand strong, to make a resolute decision never to envy the life of the past, never to envy citizenship of Egypt. Jesus. Because they were getting free food, the people prefer to remain in bondage. Can you imagine that? Because they were getting everything free, they prefer to live in bondage. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 1 verse 8, daughter Zion is left like a shelter in the vineyard. The daughter of Zion is left like a shelter in the vineyard, like a hut in the cucumber field, like a city under siege. You know what that means? The people of God, the daughter of Zion, the Israelites, the king's children, were in Egypt living in the cottage, in the shelter, in the hut. These are houses built in the farm so that you don't need to go back to the house and come back the next day. You just live in the farm. You are farming. You just come out in the morning. You continue to walk till night. In the night, you put on your lamp. You continue to walk until you get tired and you sleep off. Rain is falling. You get into the shelter. And that was the reward that the Egyptians gave to the people of God, to the daughter of Zion, to live in the cottage, to live in the vineyard. They gave them shelter in the vineyard. Just little shelter to barely accommodate them. Just to prevent them from freezing. Giving them little shelter. No comfort. But the Egyptians were growing fat. They were living in the best of houses. But the Israelites were slaves, living in the cottage, living in the mud house, in the hut, in shambles. They were living in abject poverty. Even though they can get the cucumber from the field and eat freely, even though they could eat the watermelon and garlic freely, even though they could just get to the fish pond and take some fish and eat, and because they had shelter, they had clothing, and they had food. And they told themselves, what else do I need in life? After all, these are the basic necessities of life. And they were complacent, and they were comfortable. Anytime you are comfortable in a situation, watch it out. Something may be wrong. The Israelites were comfortable in their state of bondage. Until when God says, it is a shame for my people to live in shambles. No wonder Amos chapter 6 verse 1 says, woe to them who are complacent on Zion. Those who are who are not prayerful when things are bad. People are supposed to pray and not praying. The Lord says, woe to them. People who prefer to be in bondage, who prefer to be in a backsliding state of life, whose spiritual life is in a total decay, and they are comfortable with that state of life. The Lord is calling us back home in these fasting and prayers. The Lord is talking to somebody. Jesus. Because they were given free accommodation, they preferred to live, to be slaves. That is not different from the type of life many of us are living today. Many of us are comfortable with the lifestyle we are living, even though we know it does not glorify God. But God is saying, come back. When the Israelites were in Egypt, the Egyptians were flogging them. Remember, they were slaves. So you flog the slaves. You maltreated them. But when they remember the free fish, they remember the free accommodation, the free food, and they told them, well, this is okay. How can it be okay? Are you eating free fish and free cucumber right now? God is calling on us in this fasting. The Lord is talking to us. It's time to make a U-turn. The Lord says in Isaiah chapter 58, verse 1, they shout it aloud. Do not hold back. Raise your voice like a trumpet. Declare to my people their rebellion, and to the descendants of Jacob their sins. The Lord is talking to us. It's time to go back to the Lord. Yes, God wants to bless us in this fasting. The Lord has clearly spoken to me, and he said, and I will restore their broken walls. I will repair their broken walls. And I, the Lord, will bless my children. But at the same time, and before the Lord will do that, he wants our hearts. He wants us to rend our hearts. He wants us to give our hearts to him. He wants us to surrender. We have to surrender to him, otherwise we shall be surrounded by the enemy. Otherwise we'll be overcome by the enemy. The Lord is talking to somebody. Jesus. As we are engaging in this fasting and prayers, we're asking the Almighty God to strengthen us. Let this fasting open the windows of heaven for your children of God. Anything that wants to make me to backslide, anything that wants to make me to put to shame, Father, deliver me. Papa, deliver me. In the name of Jesus. Through this fasting, Lord, I will see your face. Through this fasting, Lord, I will be vindicated. I will be delivered. In the name of Jesus. Through this fasting, Lord, I will have testimonies. In the name of Jesus. Through the fasting, Lord, I am coming out of Egypt. I will not remain in Egypt. I will not build in Egypt. I will not remain there. In the name of Jesus, open your mouth and pray now. Begin to call on the Lord. Through my Lord, through this fasting and prayers, Father, decorate me. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, through the fasting, Lord, let me have story to tell, good stories to tell. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Every spirit of bondage that wants to keep me comfortable in Egypt, Papa, deliver me. Papa, deliver me. In the name of Jesus. Ask him to deliver you. Ask him to deliver you. Papa, deliver me. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Every spirit that wants to keep me comfortable in Egypt, I cancel it now. I destroy it now. I set them on fire in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Begin to pray now. Begin to call him now. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord strengthen you. May the Lord fortify you. In the name of Jesus. While in Egypt, there were slaves. How can a slave have a house? Does a slave have a house? No. A slave does not have anything of his own or her own. He is just a slave. Many of us are just that way. We are not achieving anything in life. We don't own anything in life. The only thing that we have is something barely for a living. That was the life of the Israelites when they were in Egypt. They were living in cottage, in the huts. Just a mere shelter. They don't have bank accounts. Although they eat morning, afternoon, and night, because they need energy to do the work for the Israelites, for the Egyptians. And so they gave them free food. Just barely for a living. Does that look like your life? I want to tell you, not only are you coming out from that state situation, not only are you coming out from that Egypt, but it is time for you to begin to have your own house. It is time for you to have your own works of your hand. It is time for you to start to build. It is time for you to get into a project. It is time to have a focused life in the name of Jesus. And that brings us to the fasting purpose. The theme of this 57 days fasting is rebuilding every broken wall and completing every project in my life. You see that? Jesus. So, if your life has been like a life without project, a life without building, a life that is a dungeon, a life in the valley, a life in the pit of life. Oh, that reminds me. When somebody is in the pit, you don't see the sun because right there in the pit is darkness. No wonder David says in Psalm 23 that he dwelt in the valley of the shadow of death. Because when you are in the valley of life, you don't see the sun. Because the trees will cover you and cast shadow over you. The mountains will cast their shadow over you. If you need light, you go to the mountain. You don't go to the valley. It's time to come out of the valley, brother. It's time to come out of that shamble, my sister. Did the Bible not tell us in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 4a, tell those who dwell in the valley that the valley shall be exalted. The valley shall be exalted in the name of Jesus. It's time to go to the mountain of testimonies. It's time to get into the life of Christ. It's time to have a rebuilding experience. It's time to have a life that is a package, not a life that is disintegrating in the name of Jesus. Maybe your life has been in pieces, in shambles, in total disarray. It's time to build you back. It's time to rebuild you. That is what the fast is talking about. Rebuilding every broken wall and completing every project in my life. If you don't have a project, ask the Lord to start a project for you. Ask Him to get you into a project. Let him take you into a place where people will listen to your testimony. It's time to listen to your testimony, brother. You have listened to other people's testimonies a lot. It's time for people to listen to yours. When I'm talking about projects, I mean things like spiritual life. Saying, Lord, revive me through this prayer that I shall be full of fire. Make me a firebrand Christian. Make me a moving fire. That's a project. Jesus. Revive my career. Bring life into my career. This is my dry bone experience. Father, let flesh cover these bones and let life come into them. Let the dry bones come back to life. It's a project. In Ezekiel chapter 37, the Spirit of the Lord took Ezekiel for a project to see the lost project. He took him to the valley of the dry bones, a valley without life, a valley without hope, a valley without testimony. People with closed destinies, closed chapters, bones everywhere. God asked Ezekiel, man of God, could these bones come back to life? And he said, Lord, only you know it. And before his eyes, miracles started to happen. There was rebuilding. You see, rebuilding. The bones are scattered, started to join back, started to join together, bone to bone. That's the rebuilding project, right? Before you know what's happening, tendons started joining the bones together. That's like playing a movie and playing it in a playback mode. I hope you understand what I'm talking about. And then, after the tendons covered, joined the bones, now and behold, flesh covered the object. Now forming a corpse, human being without life. And Lord commanded Ezekiel, prophesy that the Spirit of the Lord shall come into these corpses. And he did. And the four pillars of the earth opened their windows for the Spirit of the Lord to come upon them. And Lord said that they stood up. Hey! Bones stood up. And they were like a mighty army. You know that? That is a completed project. At the beginning of the project, it was bones, hopelessness. But at the end of the project, it was a gallant army, a vibrant army, full of energy, full of life. You know why? Because the hand of the Lord was in the project. When the hand of the Lord is in the project, in your project, you are embarking on, I tell you, you will complete it. You will complete it. Life will come into that dead project. This project you have been carrying all these years, you have not gone anywhere. You are still at the foundation. And people are laughing at you. And they're telling you you cannot complete it. I want to tell you, you will complete it. You will complete it in the name of Jesus. The Bible says in Zechariah chapter 4, verse 9, O Zerubbabel, your hand started this project. Your hand laid the foundation of the temple. Your hand will complete it. And the Bible says, Zechariah 4, verse 10, do not despise the days of little beginning. You see, Ezekiel, when the Lord asked him, man of God, could these bones, dry bones, come back to life? He said, Lord, only you know it. And before his eyes, the Lord said, command, declare, prophesy that these bones will come together. And he prophesied. And the bones came together. So before the bones came together, Ezekiel had a role to play. Before your bones will come together, you have a role to play. You have to prophesy. You have to speak out something. God wanted Ezekiel to say something. God wanted Ezekiel to minister something. God wanted him to declare something. Did the Bible not tell us in Job chapter 22, verse 28, that righteous shall declare a thing, and it shall come to pass? The Lord wanted to hear Ezekiel say something. The Bible tells us in Numbers chapter 14, verse 28, that which I've heard you say, that I will do. How Jesus, it is time for you to declare now that it's time, that in this fasting and prayers, my bones will come together. My state of misery will come together. In the name of Jesus, everything that is in shambles in my business, my career that is in shambles, my marriage that is in shambles, my destiny that is in shambles, my family that is in shambles, they are coming together now.
They are coming together now. I command them to come together. I come command them to come together. Let them begin to be rebuilt now. Let them begin to undergo rebuilding. Rebuilding project, rebuilding project. In this very fasting and prayers. Yeah. My testimony has been arranged in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Begin to declare it now. This my marriage is going to be rebuilt in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. My prayer line shall be rebuilt in the name of Jesus. Begin to declare it now. Begin to declare it now. It's ours. And the Bible says, Matthew 12, 37, for by my words shall I be justified, and by my words shall I be condemned. Have you declared something? Have you declared something? Begin to declare it now, so that the Lord shall justify you. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. In this very fast and prayers, they shall be rebuilt in my life. My destiny shall be rebuilt. My health that is in shambles shall be rebuilt. They shall be rebuilt in them. I am a building project. The Lord is rebuilding me. In the name of Jesus, I will start a project, and that project shall be completed. In the name of Jesus, the ones I have started shall be completed. In the name of Jesus, Maya Kandaya Rabu, begin to pray now. Begin to pray now. Come on, Jesus. Come on, Jesus. Let it rebuild you. Let it rebuild you. In the name of Jesus, let it rebuild you. In the name of Jesus. It is forbidden for the children of Zion, the children of God, to be complacent in Egypt, to be comfortable in the land of slavery. A land without focus, a land without pasture. That was the land that the man called Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan. That was where he found himself in life. And he was living in such abject misery. Until when God remembered Mephibosheth, a man who was crippled, he wasn't born crippled, but the forces fighting him that wanted him to be destroyed, okay, to be in shambles, crippled him. Even made him an orphan, took his mother, killed the mother, killed the father, and now sent somebody to come and kill him, somebody who wanted to destroy everything that had to do with Saul. By that time, Saul was already dead, this King Saul. Jonathan, the father of Mephibosheth, was already dead. And this man said, I will kill everybody in the house of Saul. And Mephibosheth was the only one remaining. Hell. And the Holy Spirit entered into a woman who knew about the plan to exterminate her family. And she grabbed Mephibosheth in a hurry, running with the Mephibosheth. Behold, something happened. There was an accident on the road. And this little boy slipped out of her hand. And that was how Mephibosheth became crippled. You see that? The original mission of that woman was to take a Mephibosheth to a land of pasture, to the city gates, to the place of glory. But because of the way Mephibosheth had been crippled, Mephibosheth was then diverted to the place without pasture. And that was where he was for years until he got married and had a thriving family. Until when God touch the heart of King David to inquire, is there any person still alive in the house of Saul or in the house of Jonathan? And that was how somebody told the king, yes, there was one called Mephibosheth. And he sent for him. And he brought him to the king's palace. From prison to palace. From pastureless life to pasture. From dry land to the Garden of Eden, the Garden of the Lord. That is a life, reconstructed life. Only the Lord can do that. Only the Lord can do that. That is the Lord's project. Mephibosheth was a classical example of dry bones, hopeless situations. But the Lord repackaged him. The Lord touched him. The Lord brought him back to life.
And that was how Mephibosheth found a home in the palace, living with the king. His address changed. No more would you go to the land of without pasture to look for him, but to see him in the king's palace. That is what God is going to do in your life in these fasting and prayers. That's why this fasting and prayers is a destiny changing prayer, and you cannot afford to miss any day of this fasting. Anything that will make you to miss these prayers and fasting, may God arrest that situation in the name of Jesus. Jesus.
Oh! My dear friends in Christ, may God strengthen us. May He renew us. May He fortify us.
May He make us a testimony in the name of Jesus.
When the people of Israel were in Egypt,
their life was not a life of testimony. God wanted to take them to a land of testimony by taking them to the land full of milk and honey. But on the way, they had to pass through some trials. And when the trials started, they wished to go back to Egypt. They wanted to go back to what they used to do. They preferred to backslide. My dear friends in Christ, when you have time, read Exodus chapter 14 in full, and you see how the Lord was very disgusted, very disappointed with the people who chose to rebel against Moses. That even in one of the episodes, Moses commanded the earth to open, and a certain clan had to enter into the ground live. That's how grieved the Lord was because of their rebellion, because of their faithlessness. Let us be strong. Let us be strong. We cannot go back. We shall stand strong in the name of Jesus. We shall tell ourselves that we must finish strong. I will not end up in the desert. Remember that the Israelites, when they rebelled against the Lord, at the point the Lord said, none of this generation will see the promised land. And they didn't see the promised land. None of that generation that rebelled against the Lord saw the promised land. They entered into the promised land because of backsliding. Even though they were in the desert, they were out of Egypt, but they were still in Egypt. You've got to ask yourself this question. Even though I have confessed my sins and I have declared publicly that Jesus Christ is my Lord, but the life I live, is it a life of Egypt? Is it like being in Egypt? Jesus. The Lord is talking to us. We should not backslide. We cannot, because of the enticing and appealing look of the cucumber or fish or melon and our free food, and decide to go back to Egypt. The Lord says, my people should not do that. You see that? The enemy always likes to use things beautiful, things that are free, to entice us, to make us to backslide. Remember the first backsliding in the Garden of Eden? It was a free apple. It was a free apple, something free. Adam and Eve did not work for that apple. It was a free apple. Be careful with things you get for free. If it doesn't come from the Lord, it's a trap. Jesus. I once talked to a woman who married with children, but the husband was not as rich as one other man who was giving her money, and she wanted to divorce the husband just on that basis. And I told her, he cannot do it. because your husband is not as financially strong like that man, then you want to divorce him on that basis. I say, my hand is not there. The church I go, the Holy Catholic Church, does not teach that, and I cannot teach you what is not in the scripture and what the church does not teach. I said, okay, what is the motivation? He said, brother, this man takes care of me. And then? He said, but brother, I got to pay my rent. I said, and then? Be careful with free cottage, free shelter. That thing that somebody is giving to you, but there's an attachment to it. Be warned. When the Lord gives you his own, there's no attachment. The Lord gives his own free. It's unthinkable that Brother Okwe will tell you, okay, before I pray for you, give me $2,000. Before I pray for you, you buy something for me. That's a sorry situation. It's a terrible situation. The gift you are giving is not meant to be sold. Freely you received, freely you shall give. Period. Anything other than that is fake. If any man of God tells you, bring money for me to pray for you, go and sow a seed before I pray for you. Go and buy a land before I pray for you. Know that it is F-A-K-E, fake, with exclamation mark. So you know it's serious. Jesus. How come we are preferring to live in Egypt, to backslide? The people who backslided among the community of Israelites, why they were in the desert, they didn't make it to the promised land. They didn't finish well. They didn't finish strong. They didn't finish strong. You see that? For you to finish strong, you must anchor on the Lord. You must put your trust in the Lord. For some days now, the Lord has been talking to us on the subject of finishing strong. And now, on this day of our fasting, the Lord is hammering it again that he wants us to finish strong. And he wants to see us to be like him. He wants everything in our lives that do not bring glory to him to be removed. That's why in Isaiah chapter 61 that we read in the course of the fasting today, the first verse, Isaiah chapter 58 verse 1 says, shout it aloud. Do not hold it back. Raise your voice like a trumpet. Declare to my people their rebellion, to the descendants of Jacob their sins, because they have backslided. And even though they backslided and they were fasting, doing and living their lives in a worldly way, but yet they were fasting. But they were not bringing glory to the Lord. The fasting was not glorifying the Lord. And so they did not see the result of that fasting. They didn't see the result of that fasting bear good fruit in their lives. And they started to complain, why are we fasting? And the Lord is not answering us. The Lord told them in Isaiah chapter 58 verse 3, why are you saying we have fasted and the Lord have not seen it? Why have we humbled ourselves and you have not noticed? And Lord says, because you exploit your workers, because you quarrel. Isaiah chapter 58 verse 4, your fasting ends in quarrel and strife. Now, I'm reading the scripture now. This is not my brother Okwe declaring from, this is not from my head. I'm not quoting scripture from my head. I am looking at the Bible right now. Isaiah chapter 58 verse 4, your fasting ends in quarrel and strife. And in striking each other with wicked feast, that is why I didn't answer your fasting. We are there fasting? Oh, yes. Did Lord answer them? No. It's not every fasting that the Lord answers. These people backslided. They were living in sin, and they didn't want to acknowledge their sins. They didn't want to go back to the Lord. And the Lord told Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 58, verse 1, take your trumpet, go to the mountain, and blow the trumpet. Tell my people, the descendants of Jacob, to come back from their wicked ways, to return from where they have been lost. Let them reject sin and rebellion. That was the beginning of this that chapter. That verse 1. The Lord was talking about repentance. Because there is a strong connection between repentance and the receiving from the Lord. Two days ago, we had a talk titled Finishing Strong, Volume 4, and the Lord taught us on the steps we need to be restored to the Lord, to have a relationship with the Lord restored. And we talked about conviction, and then we talked about confession. Then we talked about repentance, and then forgiveness. You see that? And the same thing the Lord is talking about in Isaiah chapter 58. The Lord has been preparing us for a day like this. When he ministered to me to preach on finishing strong, I didn't even understand where he was taking us to. I didn't even know what he wanted out of it. But now it's getting clearer to me. We have been having a series of ministrations titled Finishing Strong. 2 days ago, we had up to the fourth volume. And today is the fifth volume. And so the title of this talk is Finishing Strong, Volume 5. This Volume 5 is a compendium of everything the Lord has been talking to us about, preparing us on a day like this so that we take off like a rocket through this fasting. And then we have to end well in fasting. You got to tell yourself, I will finish well in this fasting, in the name of Jesus. I will finish well. Any way the enemy wants to distract me, I cancel it in the name of Jesus. I will not backslide in the fasting. I will not yield to the voice of the enemy in the fasting. I will not give up in the name of Jesus. Now remember, in Isaiah 8 that we read during the day, of the fasting. The people were fasting, but while they were fasting, they were exploiting workers, their workers. They were practicing injustice. In fact, in verse 4 of Isaiah chapter 58, the Bible says, while they were fasting, they were quarreling. They had a strife. They were fighting each other. They were striking each other. You see that? And the Lord asked the question, is that what you call fasting? Jesus. You see, when you want to get into serious fasting, let me tell you, the enemy will come to fight that fasting. He wants to make that fasting not to be fruitful. He wants to make that fasting to be starving. You see, when you are fasting, but you are not in the spirit, it is called starving. But when you are in the spirit, when the spirit of true fasting is in you, and you are fasting, that is fasting. So the enemy wants you to be quarreling during a fasting, so be warned, because he wants to make somebody to make you get annoyed. You may be driving to work, and somebody will not give you right of way. Simple things like that. They can grieve you if you're not careful, but just keep it behind and keep moving. Whatever happens in the house or in the office that may provoke you, it is time for you to, even from the morning of the door of the fasting, tell the Lord, help me not to fall into the trap of the enemy today. Help me to have a fruitful fasting today. Commend that fasting to the hands of the Lord. And that reminds me, when you are going to fasting, you pray about the fasting. Tell the Lord, look at the purpose of the fasting. Father, you need to bless me. 20-minute fasting. For without you, I cannot make it. And when you are closing it, When the fasting comes to an end, don't just rush into the food. Pray and close it. And thank the Lord for the grace He has given to you. And if you have opportunity to attend Mass, good. If you don't, no problem. But pray before you close the fasting. Talk to the Lord. You know why the people were crying and striving? Because the devil wants to pollute their fasting. He wants their fasting not to be fruitful. He kept them backsliding. Kept them in a backsliding state of life. And the Lord told them, I cannot answer you if this is how you do your fasting.
The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 58 verse 5, oh, is this the kind of fast I have chosen? Only a day for people to humble themselves? Is it only for bowing one's head like a reed and for lying in sackcloth and ashes? Is that what you call a fast? A day acceptable to the Lord? And the Lord now tells us, this is true fasting. Isaiah chapter 58 verse 6. To loose the chains of injustice, to untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free, to break every yoke. Is it not to share your food with the hungry, to provide the poor wanderer with shelter, and see the naked to clothe them, and not to turn away or turn away from your own flesh and blood? Then your light we break forth like the dawn. That is to say, your testimony will break forth like the dawn. Your healing will come quickly. The glory of the Lord will come on you. Then you will call on me, Isaiah chapter 58 verse 9 says, and I will answer you. You will cry for help, and I will answer. I say, here am I. If you do not help with the yoke of oppression, with the pointing finger and the malicious talk, and if you spend yourself or yourselves in behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness and your night will become like the noonday. The Lord will always be with you always and will satisfy your needs in the sun-scorched land and will strengthen your frame. Sun-scorched land is a barren land. And Lord says, even that barren land, I'll make it fruitful. This was the secret of Isaac. Isaac was in Gerar. Gerar was having unfruitfulness. But the Lord blessed Isaac in Genesis chapter 26, verse 12. He sowed a grain of seed in the ground. And at the end of the year, he reaped 100. While the whole city, the whole nation, the whole place of Gerar in Philistine happened to be in their famine. Somebody's investments was prospering. May that be your testimony in the name of Jesus. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord make you strong. Through this fasting, may the Lord rebuild you. May the Lord rebuild you. I repeat again, may the Lord rebuild you in the name of Jesus. Yes, Lord. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 58, verse 12b, you will be called a repairer of broken walls. Ah! Did you hear that? You will be called repeller of broken walls. The ones who repair is called repeller. Do you still remember the title of this talk? Or rather the title of this fasting and prayers? Did the Lord not tell us in the fasting and prayers that this will be titled Rebuilding Every Broken Wall and the Completing Every Project in My Life? Jesus, and Lord says, Isaiah chapter 58, verse 12b, He said, and you will be a repairer of broken walls. And so the Lord is saying, through this fasting, your walls, your broken walls, shall be repaired, because the hand of the Lord will be with you. And He said, your people will rebuild the ancient ruins, and will raise up the age-long foundations. Ancient ruins, places that have been forgotten. Your great-grandfather made that ruin and didn't do anything. And it has been like that today. But through this fasting, every ancient gate, every ancient parameter, every ancient foundation,
will be like a well-watered garden. Isaiah chapter 58, verse 11, C. That you shall be like a well-watered garden. Have you seen a well-watered garden? Looking well, looking good, healthy. Like a tree planted by rivers of water. That's what the Lord says. And that's what the Lord says about you. That's what God is talking about you, not another person. May God bless you in this fasting. May the Lord fortify you in this fasting. Through this fasting, may your testimonies surround you. In the name of Jesus. And so the Lord is asking us to stand strong. Never to go back to Egypt. But to put our hands on the plow and look forward. To look unto Jesus. Never to backslide. We shall not backslide. Jesus. The Bible tells us in Galatians chapter 5, verse 1, so stand firm and do not take on yourself the yoke of slavery. A second time. Bible is good, though. Did you hear that thing? Galatians chapter 5, verse 1, God is saying, stand firm. Stand firm, stand firm, stand firm. And do not take on yourself the yoke of slavery. A second time. That second time. The second time is telling us that this people, there was a time they had the yoke of slavery. But now they gave their life to Christ, repented. But now later, they went back to slavery and took the yoke of slavery the second time. May that not be my portion in the name of Jesus. Every spirit that wants me to go back to and take up the yoke of slavery the second time, I reject it, I bind it, I cancel it in the name of Jesus. I will not go back to Babylon again. I will not go back to Egypt again in the name of Jesus. Mm-hmm. Jesus. Going back, a lot of people prefer to be they are comfortable with their bondage. A sister was sharing with me some time ago how a man, a patient they were taking care of, I think she was the one taking care of the patient in the hospital, and clinically, this man was ready to go, free to go, and then he was discharged, but he didn't want to go. He told the sister, look, I prefer to be here. If I go back to the house, I don't have money to take care of my children this Christmas, and my wife is going to deal with me, and so it's better for me to stay here. So please don't write that I am clinically fit to leave. This man preferred to be in the hospital, eating free food, receiving free treatment, having free accommodation, cottage. These are the signs of a backsliding child of God. But this fasting is a wake-up call to stand strong, to stand our feet, and never to look back like the wife of Lot. We cannot look back. The Galatians started in the spirit. They were living life in the spirit, but turned to the works of the flesh. We see that in Galatians chapter 3, verse 3. Some of you hearing my voice, fell in love with Jesus some years ago, but let that return to your sins, to your old ways. In the same disgusting way that the dog returns its vomit. In fact, 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 22 says, what the true proverb says has happened to me or to them. The dog returns to its own vomit. Jesus. The Lord is talking to us, brother. It's time to stand strong. When we take our eyes off Jesus, we fall away from our first love for him. Remember Revelation 2, verse 4. The Spirit of the Lord was admonishing the church for forsaking their first love.
When you backslide, the world entices us with its allurements and its seductions.
After we have taken our eyes off Jesus for a long enough period of time, amazingly, the chains of slavery start to look good. Oh, yeah.
In fact, the saint-turned sinner actually prefers the old chains, saying,
I find the old one better. Luke chapter 5, verse 39. That is life in hell. That's not the life God is calling us into. God is talking to us today.
The people of Israel, while they were in the dry land, while they were in the desert, they experienced pains, they experienced hardship, and they preferred to go back.
One of the things the enemy uses to afflict the children of God is pain, bringing suffering, so that you give up. But God is calling us to trust in Him. The disposition to endure pain and suffering are necessary in order to overcome the enemy. It's very important. Endurance is very important. Patience is very important in our Christian journey. We must realize that every process of growth involves pain. I hope you know that. Like Daniel and Paul, we must be disposed even to suffer. Because the time the Lord asked us to carry, remember the Lord said, if you love me, carry your cross and follow me. Matthew chapter 16, verse 24. When you carry the cross, it's no more comfortable. It becomes a season of suffering. Sometimes the Lord allows such season to come to a child of God. Everything cannot be just bed of roses. You know that, of course? Oh, that reminds me. In Acts chapter 14, verse 22, the Bible says, and this was Paul talking, through much pain, we will enter the kingdom. Through much pain, we will enter the kingdom. You see that? So sometimes the suffering, the pain, the hardship, we pass through. It's also a refining process for us to get to the next level in our spiritual life. Not to go back to Egypt.
So we must develop a mind, the mind or disposition to endure. Endure them while they last.
Because through them, God is processing miracles and greatness for us.
So when you are passing through challenges,
as far as it is settled in your mind that you are in the right standing with the Lord, know that the Lord is processing a miracle for you. The Lord is processing a miracle for you. And a big miracle, for that matter, if that miracle is tallying, know that's a big miracle. By the way, when you go to order food, maybe a pizza, and you order for special order, you have to wait. You have to wait. A long time, you have to wait till that pizza is ready. If you want to ready made, you may not even spend 30 seconds there. You get done. The processing gets completed. You just pay and they give you ready made. But when it's tailored to your taste, when it is the condiment, the ingredients are your test, you have to wait. 50 people may come and take their oil in a hurry because it's ready-made. But because you needed a special service, a special product, then you have to wait. We know how to do that at Pizza Hut. How come we don't know how to do that in the spiritual realm? That the reason why that miracle is being delayed could be because the Lord is processing a big miracle for you. The enemy can delay it, sure, but you know what I'm talking about? If you are truly serving the Lord with all your heart and you're in prayers, I tell you, when it's delayed, God allowed it because He's processing a big miracle for you. And even if the enemy is standing on the way, the Lord is just giving him a chance to play a role like He played in the death of Job.
So God is talking to us this night. This very fasting cannot elude me. me. I will not end this year in shame, in shamble. The Lord will decorate me. The Lord will decorate you. Open your mouth and declare it. And say, Lord, I know you will decorate me. Yes, my Lord. I know you will restore me. I know you will revive me. I know you will fortify me. I know you will make me to have joy. I know you are doing something great for me. I know that this person is for my own good. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. This fasting is for my good. It's for my liberation. It's for my testimony. Always tell yourself that. So when the enemy comes, you just tell him, you know what? You can't distract me. The enemy may send a spirit of fear. Fear makes us spiritually weak, even discouraged. But you know what? Don't allow fear to drain your strength. Trust in the Lord. When you fear, even what you fear begins to come. In fact, fear has an attractive power that brings evil into our lives. That's why Job tells us in Job 3:25, the things I fear have finally happened to me. So we reject every negative emotion the enemy may send as an arrow into our lives in fasting. I will finish strong. I will finish strong. Always tell yourself that in the course of this fasting. I will not sink. Peter started to fear. He started thinking, but my story shall be different. I shall not sink. In the name of Jesus, through this fasting, I will walk on the water. I will walk over commotion. I will walk over crisis. I will walk over troubles. In the name of Jesus, I will walk over challenges of the enemies against my life. I will walk over them. I will have testimonies in the name of Jesus. I will see myself in a dream walking on the ocean in the name of Jesus. I will physically walk over joblessness in the name of Jesus. I will walk over sickness in the name of Jesus. I will stampede them in the name of Jesus. Jesus. And so, Father, we concentrate on you in this fasting. We look unto you in this fasting, Lord. From the rising of the sun to the setting of the sun, we shall continue to praise you. We shall not backslide. I shall finish fasting, and I will finish strong. I will finish my Christian race, and I will finish strong. In the name of Jesus. So, Father, we thank you for this message. We'll cover this message, blood of Jesus. We'll cover our lives, blood of Jesus. We'll cover the blessings we receive today in this fasting, blood of Jesus. Even the blessings we receive in the course of these prayers and liberation, blood of Jesus. Father, the remaining days of this fasting, we'll cover, blood of Jesus. Even the fasting of tomorrow, Father, we'll soak in the blood of Jesus. Every spirit that wants to bring distraction or wants to make me to give up in this fasting or wants to tell me that I cannot make it or want to give me reasons why I cannot make it, Father, I reject that spirit. I pin that spirit down with my faith in you in the name of Jesus. Father, this fasting shall be the beginning of greater things in my life. Father, I prophesy upon my life that I shall finish well and I shall finish strong in the name of Jesus. Jesus. That through this fasting, my broken walls shall be restored, shall be rebuilt. For I am a rebuilder of broken walls in the name of Jesus. And every project I embark on shall be completed. So, Father, we thank you. Blessed be your name. Ancient of Days, we thank you. In the name of Jesus, we cover the fast, the prayer, blood of Jesus. We cover today's message with the blood of Jesus. We cover our night's sleep with the blood of Jesus, and we decree that no weapon formed or designed against us shall prosper. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, mighty God. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.